Hello, and welcome to today's webinar, The Role of National Service in Improving K-12 Education Outcomes. I'm Betsy Brand, Executive Director of the American Youth Policy Forum, and I'll be serving as the moderator of today's webinar. We're very excited to be co-sponsoring this webinar with our partner, Service Year Alliance. For those of you who are attending your first AYPF event, AYPF is a nonpartisan convener that brings policymakers, educators, and researchers together in order to facilitate dialogue that leads to more informed policy to improve the lives of America's youth, and particularly those who are traditionally underserved. And if you're unfamiliar with Service Year Alliance, that organization is dedicated to making a year of service a common expectation and opportunity for every young American as a way to tackle important challenges while transforming their own lives. Before we begin, I'll quickly run through a few logistical points. In the event of any technical difficulties, you may dial 1-800-263-6317 to reach GoToWebinar's technical support line. And if you happen to lose connectivity at any time during the webinar, please just go ahead and use the same link to log back to the webinar. Throughout the webinar, we encourage you to type your questions for the presenters in the questions box on your screen to the right, and we'll have a number of scheduled breaks for Q&A. We'll try to get to all your questions throughout the presentations, but if we don't, we will do our best to follow up after the webinar. Upon the completion of the webinar, the slides and the recording will be posted on AYPF's website, www.ayPF.org, and also on Service Year Alliance's website at www.serviceyear.org. So today's webinar is the first of a three-part webinar series that will examine the benefits of service to educational outcomes, to workforce talent, and to the pool of skilled nonprofit workers. The second webinar has now been scheduled and will be held on November 14th, and the third webinar will be held in December, so please stay tuned for that. Today's webinar is focused on how service can contribute to improving basic educational skills such as reading and math literacy, improving grades, reducing disruptive behaviors, and connecting students to caring mentors. This webinar will illustrate the role national service plays in helping communities design and implement locally determined, results-driven, cost-effective solutions to improve student outcomes, and we will be featuring some program examples and way that you can leverage national service in your own community. So I'll introduce the speakers in the order that they will be presenting. First, we will hear from Rosa Moreno, who's the Chief Growth Officer for Service Year Alliance. Then we'll hear from Lindsay Dolce, who's the Chief Advancement Officer at Reading and Math Corps. We'll take a few questions following those two presenters. Our third presenter will be Casey Waugh, Senior Administrator at Evans High School in the Orange County Public School District in Orlando, Florida. And our final presenter will be Leander Foley, Managing Partner, Capitol Hill Partners. We will quickly return to Rosa after Lee has finished to describe some available resources that provide more information about the value of service and how to start a program in your community. As a reminder, we will pause intermittently for audience questions, so please be sure to send your questions in via the chat box. For the social media enthusiasts among us, we will be live tweeting today's webinar, and we encourage you to join the conversation using the hashtag @ServiceYear or hashtag @LetUsServe, which you see on the screen. And also listed on the screen are the Twitter handles of our presenters and our organizations. So, without further ado, I'd like to invite Rosa Moreno, the Chief Growth Officer for Service Year Alliance, to the virtual podium. Rosa.
Thanks, Betsy, for the introduction. I'm honored to be here today to introduce the role Service Years can have in working with schools, organizations, and communities to help improve education outcomes. In fact, I'm pleased to join this conversation, not only because I'm a former middle school teacher, but also served as an AmeriCorps member for 2 years, where I was a bilingual early literacy tutor in Texas. And since then, I spent most of my career working to help organizations and communities utilize Service Years as a strategy. For the next few minutes, I get to share with you and sets the stage for how Service Year programs provide vital support to students across the nation. Next slide, please. First, I want to start with defining what is a service year. As you can see from this slide, when we say service year, we are speaking about those year-long, full-time, paid opportunities in which individuals enroll to tackle pressing challenges while developing real-world skills. Currently, there are over 65,000 opportunities, domestic and abroad, for individuals to serve full-time with programs that offer various opportunities focused on different issues and in diverse geographic locations. It's an extraordinary year that transforms the life of the individuals while making a positive impact on the community. It's programs like the Peace Corps, Youth Build, and hundreds of AmeriCorps programs such as Teach for America, City Year, and Jumpstart, and a few that you'll hear about later today. Next slide. Today, we're here to talk about the role of service years in improving K-12 education outcomes. We know that school and district leaders around the country are working tirelessly to provide a quality education to our students. At Service Year Alliance, we want to showcase how service year programs support school and student success. Education is the largest area of focus for many service year programs across the country. These programs play a vital role in helping communities design and implement results-driven, cost-effective solutions that support students from cradle to career. More than 44,000 National Service Year members provide in-school and after-school support to at-risk youth serving in almost 12,000 schools, including one out of every four low-performing schools and one out of every 10 charter schools. Next slide, please. Service Year programs provide vital support across the nation, supporting students at various points across their academic journey. Rigorous independent evaluations have demonstrated that service year programs improve school readiness, they increase reading and math achievement, improve school attendance and behavior, and increase access to college and careers. The thousands of service year corps members provide human capital to support student and school success and are serving as teachers, tutors, extracurricular providers, and in other roles that focus on outcomes at various stages of the cradle to career continuum. When you ask yourself, what is your district's most urgent challenge when it comes to students? We hope that you come to see Service Year as part of that solution. Next slide. In a short moment, we're going to hear directly from two programs, but before we do, I wanted to share some quick examples. So Playworks is an the Playworks AmeriCorps members provide school-wide evidence-based program designed to utilize play to create school environments with reduced bullying, where students feel safe and supported and engage in low-income schools in multiple sites across the nation. These AmeriCorps members are positively impacting the entire school climate and reduce bullying and create a safe environment. CalServes, as part of the Napa County Office of Education, utilizes AmeriCorps members to provide comprehensive tutoring, mentoring, and school climate improvement interventions to high-need students in the California's North Bay. These members are responsible for improving the academic performance of participating students in literacy and math, and these members are also leveraging volunteers and engaging them in creating a positive climate for learning. Next slide. Finally, wanted to highlight a couple more examples. The College Success Foundation utilizes AmeriCorps members who serve as college and career coaches in middle schools across five school districts in Washington State. And these AmeriCorps members work to improve students' college and career awareness and increase the school's college-going culture. We have the Colorado Youth for Change. These AmeriCorps members provide services to off-track and in-school and disengaged out-of-school youth to help them re-engage and re-enroll in school. These members help these students remain connected to an education program and support their in-school youth on their education engagement efforts. So these are just a few examples. You'll hear a little bit more. Next slide. But before I pass it on, I just wanted to cover a few things. I hope that I have piqued your interest and that you're starting to ask yourself how you can bring service year programs to your community. And if you are already utilizing service as a strategy, maybe you're asking how you can grow your program. I wanted to highlight a few ways you can achieve this, and we'll speak a little later on about additional resources for making this a reality in your community. And while This is not a detailed pathway. It gives you a high-level introduction, and more importantly, as we transition to hear from the other two speakers, I want you to listen for ways that you can engage with them as an example. But before we go, really quickly, you could replicate, which means you could design or replicate your own service, your program, using one of the models as inspiration so that you can create and run your own program. You could expand, which means you can become an expansion site for a national program, which would bring the program model to your school. You could host. You could become a host site for a local, state, or national program in your region that would bring the program model to your school. And finally, which everyone could on this call could do, we can inform. We can inform all the young people in your school and in your lives about the opportunity to do a service year and build the next generation of service leadership. As I said, as you listen to the program and school examples in today's webinars, picture how you could bring these programs or learn from their experience to your location. Betsy, thank you.
Oh, great, Rosa. That was such a great overview on the importance of service to improving educational outcomes for children and youth, just really to the point and just very comprehensive too. Before we move on to our next speaker, Lindsay, I do just want to remind the audience that in the chat box, you will find links to some of the programs that were mentioned. So you can just click on that and get more information. And we will continue to chat out links to resources during the webinar. So thank you again, Rosa. Next, we're going to hear from Lindsay Dolce, who's the Chief Advancement Officer with Reading and Math Corps. Lindsay, you're up.
Good afternoon, Betsy, and to all of those of you who are participating. I'd like to start by just saying thank you to AYPF and to Service Year for inviting us to participate in this webinar. We certainly are excited always for the opportunity to share our work with others. And without intentionally doing so, Rosa actually mentioned one of our replication partners when she was talking. I just would like to throw that out there. So Colorado Youth for a Change also is a replicator of the Reading Corps in Colorado. Kind of a fun little tidbit. So Minnesota Reading Corps, just to give you a quick overview, began as a strategic statewide initiative of Serve Minnesota, which is a nonprofit organization that oversees Minnesota's AmeriCorps state programs. AmeriCorps is often referred to as the domestic peace corps, and those who join the ranks can dedicate anywhere between 1 and 4 years of their lives to meet the critical needs in their communities. Reading Corps and Math Corps are effective because they blend what we call the people power of AmeriCorps with the science of how children learn to read and become proficient at math. Our rigorously trained tutors work with children from age 3 to grade 3 in reading and grade 4 to grade 8 in math. By harnessing the power of national service and using proven research-based instructional techniques, Reading Corps and Math Corps are making an impact for thousands of children in the United States every year. So just to give you a little bit more history, Reading Corps began in 2003 with just 24 AmeriCorps members serving 250 children. Today, more than 40,000 preschool and elementary children are being served through the programs collectively. In 2012, Reading Corps began its national expansion, and in 2015, Math Corps began its national expansion. As the largest AmeriCorps tutoring program in the country, we have the capacity to move the needle on improving both third grade reading proficiency as well as eighth grade math proficiency. Next slide, please. So those are our two educational milestones, or actually there are three really if you break it down. So Ready for Kindergarten is the purpose of our pre-K Reading Corps interventions. Proficiency at the end of third grade is the purpose of our kindergarten through third grade reading interventions, and grade 8 proficiency in algebra is the purpose of our Math Corps interventions. Next slide. So this just gives you a picture for those of you who are on the call and curious to know if Reading Corps or Math Corps are operating in your state. This is the most current map at the moment. There are several other states on here with whom we're having conversations about the possibility of replication, and certainly you could be one of them too. That's 100% what I do. So if you do find yourself interested in learning more after the call, certainly feel free to reach out to me. Next slide, please. So Reading Corps is getting results, and I'll share a little bit more about that as we get into these slides. Two rigorous studies done by NORC at the University of Chicago demonstrate that elementary schools and preschool programs implementing Reading Corps had significantly greater outcomes for their students than programs that do not have access to Reading Corps tutors. We're helping to close the achievement gap. I'll highlight in a minute that the studies found that students of color and students eligible for free and reduced price lunch, as well as English language learners, are achieving outcomes equal to or better than their peers. In fact, those with higher risk factors actually made stronger gains. Next slide, please. So what is Reading Corps, you might be wondering to yourself. We are an evidence-based literacy tutoring program delivered by AmeriCorps members, and we provide 20 minutes of daily support in the K-3 space, 5 days a week. And then tutors are embedded in the classroom, in a pre-K classroom, serving students all day long throughout the course of that day. So we're helping to improve early literacy skills required for school readiness and reading proficiency by third grade. Next slide, please. Additionally, Reading Corps trains tutors using the science of how children learn to read. We do this throughout the course of the year. As many of you, I'm sure, are aware, training someone once by attending a conference or some sort of session is effective, but what's far more effective is coaching to the training that individuals receive over the period of a full year. So we train our tutors on a monthly basis after doing an intensive 3-day training at the beginning of the year. Next slide, please. As I mentioned before, and I believe that the links are going to be coming out to you as well, Reading Corps is getting results. For those of you who are interested in digging into it a little bit more, we have both an executive summary as well as the full report available on the website about our rigorous study conducted by NORC at the University of Chicago, and just completed our second rigorous study. So we did both a randomized control trial as well as a quasi-experimental design evaluation of both our pre-K and K-3 programs. We are helping to close the achievement gap, and during our most recent study, which was our second study, we were able to dig in a little bit more as to why our work is so impactful for those individuals who have multiple risk factors. You'll find that information again in the report. The last bit to share from this slide is that Reading Corps is known to be cost effective. As an example, after doing some evaluation of the work here in Minneapolis Public Schools, we found that individuals who received Reading Corps were nearly 3 times less likely to be referred for special education services. And in extrapolating from those numbers, we calculated that a savings to the state of Minnesota is estimated to be $9 million annually. Next slide, please. So this is the picture that we refer to as the secret sauce. We know, again, as I mentioned earlier, that individuals who receive training can be effective, but what makes them most effective and what brings such impactful outcomes for our students is that we use a model that uses coaching at multiple levels. You'll see the Reading Corps and Math Corps Master Coach role. That's an individual who is working with the person we identify as the school internal coach to work with the tutors who you see in the middle there to support the students. Those are the three boxes along the bottom. And those students are participating in our work through database decision-making, evidence-based literacy interventions, and implementation fidelity. Next slide, please. So these are just a couple of little highlights that I thought I would share with all of you. So in 2018 and 19, more than 1,200 tutors are serving more than 30,000 students for Reading Corps. Both Reading Corps and Math Corps have gained national acclaim as a very effective replicator. And so, again, I would encourage any of you who are interested to reach out to me to see if we might be a fit for you. In Minnesota, since 2003, we went from 25 tutors in that first year to now having roughly 1,400 tutors annually in Minnesota. And we believe that there's a little bit of room for additional growth as we operate in 77 out of the 87 counties here in Minnesota. Both Reading Corps and Math Corps combined have 900 service sites in the state of Minnesota. Next slide, please. Which is reflected in this slide. And you'll see, we think it's very important to reach not just those in the Twin Cities or in an urban hub of your state. We recently started replicating the Math Corps in Georgia in a town called Albany, which is a much smaller place and it has been successful thus far. Next slide, please. So all of our work is built from looking at implementation of interventions through a multi-tiered systems of support, or some of you may still refer to it as response to intervention. That's really the framework we're built around. We understand that we cannot intervene our way out of core instruction deficiencies, but we can complement strong core instruction and a school that is looking to provide these interventions for students who need just a little extra help. Next slide, please. We also know that AmeriCorps or a service year are impactful because if you look at students who are struggling to reach proficiency in any subject, what you find is that they need additional interventions during a week, and teachers are already very taxed. We often say that their hair is on fire and that they're unable to get to everything that they want to get to. So what we have found is that using AmeriCorps members to serve in this capacity has been extraordinarily helpful and really has worked for all of the parties involved. Next slide, please. So I'll just walk through a few of the program evaluation results. These are where the charts and graphs come in, so take a sip of your coffee if you've got some there. Next slide, please. So Reading Core works, again, to reiterate just that we are closing the achievement gap. The model is also known to be effective in any setting. That's one of the pieces we really evaluated when we looked here in Minnesota. So we have urban, suburban, and rural settings in the state of Minnesota. In this last research evaluation, we also looked at our work in Milwaukee and Miami and found that the model is replicable in both of those communities as well. Next slide, please. Significant effects were found for all five oral, language, and emergent literacy measures, and impressive growth in vocabulary was noted as well. Next slide, please. This just shows you one of the effect sizes. So this is particularly for rhyming fluency, which is one of our pre-K measures. As you can see, the orange is actually our program. The gray is the comparison sites who are involved in the study. And you can see from fall to winter to spring, the benchmark, the target was that 12 on rhyming fluency, and the students who participated and had the interventions achieved 13.38 as a part of that effect. Next slide, please. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Math Core. So we worked heavily to bring Reading Core as an intervention here in Minnesota, and then recognized after hearing from many of the schools we were working with that math was another area where they needed some additional support and some extra help. As a result, next slide, please, we started the Math Core. In case you were wondering, this is just an overview of what NAEP shows for mathematics in the United States, and this is from the last 2015 numbers, but you can see that those are well below what we would expect and well below what is acceptable. Next slide, please. So we used our experience and created an evidence-based math tutoring program, also delivered by AmeriCorps members, and this program provides 90 minutes of weekly tutoring to students fourth through eighth grade. We're currently working to build early numeracy, which will be implemented in all of our pre-K replication sites starting in the fall of 2019, but it will be complementing what we already do in terms of early literacy. Math currently only works fourth through eighth grade, we only have tutors serving in that space, and they serve students in pairs to improve foundational math skills. They use manipulatives and work to ensure that students are ready for algebra readiness. Next slide, please. This is just a quick slide to show you. We did our first randomized control trial of our Math Core work last year. And so what you see represented in this slide is that there was a difference of 22 scaled growth score points, meaning that students who were receiving the interventions demonstrated more than 3 months additional growth than students who were in the control group. And this was just over the course of a semester. We just completed a full year study, and we'll have those results very soon. Next slide, please. What I would say about all of the focus on the studies and the evidence base is that we feel like, as good stewards of both federal dollars as well as state dollars in multiple states where we operate, it's important to be sure that what we're doing works and is actually moving the needle. And we think of ourselves as having an opportunity to provide continuous improvement. So we continue to dig in and see where we might make tweaks or do a little bit better. I appreciate the opportunity again to present. Thank you for your time, and I will hand it back over to Betsy.
Great, Lindsay, thank you. That's such a great overview of Math and Reading Core, and also really impressive research-based model. with impressive results and savings too. So you're really providing a lot of great information to people on why they should use these programs. We do have time for a couple questions. One question has come in, and this one is directed to Lindsay. So one of the participants on the webinar is asking, did the comparison sites in your studies have other types of tutoring or interventions going on?
So, that's a Lindsay? Great question. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Thank you for the question. We actually made sure that there were no other tutoring programs happening in those sites. That was a part of the control factor that we looked at. And we also looked to make sure that there weren't any reading specialists. So not just tutoring from, you know, individuals volunteering or any of that kind of stuff, but specifically any reading specialists, which was a little bit, I'll admit, a little challenging to do because people, you know, for obvious reasons, hesitate to let you say for a year these students can't get services. So in many cases, we shifted to just doing a semester.
Okay, great. Thank you. Lindsay, let me stick with you and another question before I turn to Rosa. Lindsay, so could you talk about what the partnerships with the schools have looked like and kind of how did they start? Did you run into any resistance from schools when you were trying to bring either Reading Corps or Math Corps into the school building?
That's a wonderful question. So there is, I would say, almost always at least a little bit of resistance initially. As I mentioned, you know, teachers are completely overwhelmed and taxed. Administrators in elementary schools and middle schools are also feeling that pressure. So one of the things we've been very, very conscientious of as we start these conversations with schools is to reiterate multiple times that we don't ask them to manage members. We don't ask them to hire members. We ask for their support as a partner, but we do all the heavy lifting when it comes to the managing of people and human resources. And once we get through that initial conversation and folks really truly understand that we see that as our opportunity and our way of supporting them, we've done pretty well. We find, honestly, what's been really interesting is we find that those partnerships are what drive our growth in most places. So in particular, I can speak to Colorado. Prior to joining the Reading Corps team here, I oversaw the State Service Commission in Colorado, and we were the first state to replicate Reading Corps, which is how I found out about it. We went into a really challenging school district in Colorado, and after the first year, they asked for more AmeriCorps members. And in fact, most people in that district started to understand what a service year was, which blew my mind. So it takes a little bit of time and a lot of relationship building over the course of the year, but schools end up becoming great allies for us. Thank you for the question.
Great. Thank you, Lindsay. For Rosa, you had a slide earlier that shows how service can help with kindergarten readiness all the way up to post-secondary degree completion with many types of supports in between. So just based on your experience, is it easier to start in the early grades and kind of work upwards or start at a high school level? Does it make a difference if people are trying to figure out where to start a service year program? What would you recommend to people?
Yeah, so thanks, Betsy. What you'll find in many of the instances of the programs that I describe where they are interacting at any point along the continuum is that they started where they started. And what I mean by that is there wasn't like they started at elementary and then worked their way up and they found that by starting one place and working their way into another that they found that easier. So what you'll see is that there are different models working with different age groups and all for different reasons. Most of the time what's happened is the what is needed by the school district is what drove which program started first. And then from there they identified models. So my short answer is that not at all. So you really have the flexibility to say where you need to start is where you should start, and that you can find models to either partner with so that you could host or models you could replicate at any point in time along that spectrum. The thing that I think will, in addition to the need, which is what mostly drove what someone selected as their entree point, the other part was where they had resources. In some instances, where they had buy-in either from school district leadership or financial resources, I would say was another factor that tended to drive what people paid attention to, right? With all of us, with limited resources, we focus on what's most important and most urgent. And I would say what people selected for how they brought it in is reflective of that same kind of approach.
Great. Okay. And just for our listeners, we're going to be spending some time a little bit later in the webinar talking about resources and funding supports. So we will get to that important conversation. Another question for Rosa. When people are thinking, or communities are thinking about how to get involved with service, do you find that it's more likely that they replicate a program, or do they really just kind of start brand new? I mean, is the replication aspect of this work more likely, or to create a brand new program?
Yeah, what I will say is that there are probably some things that the folks need to ask themselves, because there are a couple things. Sometimes people are in a better position where replicating is in their best interest, and some where partnering is in their best interest. Typically what drives those kind of factors are the resources and assets that are available to them. We often tell folks, don't reinvent the wheel. So if you're in a situation where what you need can be met by partnering, then start there. But if you're in a situation where that's not feasible and you really have a need, then your best bet may be to start something new. And even then, we say don't start from scratch. Don't reinvent the wheel. Make sure that you're learning from what's already out there. So I think it really depends on where you are and what you're focused on. And when we get to resources a little later, we'll talk a little bit about how you can identify resources that might be available to you to help you inform which approach you should take. To be able to make smart decisions for where you're at.
Great. Thank you. Thanks. I appreciate Rosa and Lindsay for your comments. So we're going to move to our next presenter, Casey Waugh, who's the senior administrator at Evans High School in Orlando. And she's going to be talking about how Evans High School has embedded service in multiple ways into their school day. Casey, you're on.
Thank you so much, and good afternoon from Evans High School in Orlando, Florida. Our focus is on literacy, rigor, and relationships, and our pillars of success include pride, determination, and perseverance, which is displayed daily by our students. I'm Casey Waugh, and I serve as the senior administrator for Evans, as Betsy said. My roles and responsibilities include, on any given day, teacher retention, professional learning, digital curriculum and instruction, community school liaison, and service learning supervisor. Next slide, please. Within Orange County Public Schools, our district is really a tapestry of cultures and ethnicities, and you can see that from our data at a glance before you. We at Evans are one of 20 high schools in our district, and we are a digital school who operates in a one-to-one capacity where our students have Lenovo ThinkPads that they are able to carry to and from school every day, and they get to keep them throughout the year, and that includes summer as well. Next slide, please. So for us at Evans High School, we serve a majority of African American students. Our school population, as you can see, is just over 2,500, and we have 140 instructional personnel that teach courses on our campus. Our school is unique in that we are a flagship model in Florida for community schools. And that means we have three dedicated partners who've come together within our school district as well to produce a 25-year memorandum of understanding to support Evans High School. We have our four core partners, including Orange County Public Schools, the University of Central Florida, Orange Blossom Family Health, and Children's Home Society. So all of these partners come together to provide funding and programs to support the whole student here at Evans. We're a Title I urban school in Pine Hills with pretty much 100% free and reduced lunch rates. Next slide, please. So just to brag a little bit, we are also a school that offers a myriad of programs, and those programs challenge students academically, as well as give them various opportunities to engage in college level work. Currently, we are an IB school, which is International Baccalaureate, including the Middle Years program. We are an entertainment magnet, as well as an academy of multimedia and technology. We offer advanced placement classes, the AVID program, and NJRTC, just to name a few other academic opportunities for our students. This means that our students need help. They need help in balancing the demands of academics, home life, work, sibling care, and in just general high school navigation. So this is where our service really takes flight. Next slide. In terms of our wraparound services, when we talk about our partnership, we are maintained through a governing cabinet who meet quarterly to review these goals and our data points to ensure that our overall vision is being achieved and that we're supporting students in all aspects of their life, but also that we're supporting their families. As I said previously, we're partnered with four great partners, and they're able to provide comprehensive care to students and families in the Pine Hills area on our campus. So we house all of the services that you see on the screen within our school. This is also a great opportunity to mention that we have a hub team, and the hub is really the heart of our campus. And our service learning members are also able to interact with the services that our school provides. Adults are continuously practicing service leadership on campus, and we are a model to our student body. This is the culture of Evans. And when we speak to the culture of Evans, City Year members have really every year consistently taken that motto, that method of servant leadership, and embodied it for our students, for our staff, and for our administrative team. Additionally, mentoring and after-school programs that you see on the screen are really the heart of our academic and social emotional support, and these help increase our academics, and this is where our service members are hard at work. Our wraparound services are funded through our partnerships with resources and businesses within the community. We especially lean on Orange Blossom Family Health and Children's Home Society for the medical, dental, vision, and mental health needs, as these are at no cost to the school, and they work through Medicaid as well as private insurance agencies to support our students. Next slide, please. As we mentioned, the idea of servant leadership, this is a model for the Trojan Nation. The team that we operate within includes key players that are actively serving the Evans students and by proxy, the community. Those team members that are in bold are of cost to the school or community school partnership. We have City Year members that work side by side with teachers in critical areas of math and English in ninth grade. Being such a pivotal time for students to transition to high school, oftentimes that means there's college level work involved. These service members play a critical role of mentor, friend, and tutor to these students on a daily basis. The cost to host a City Year on our campus, as we are a host site, is approximately $10,000 for the year. We provide a classroom workspace to house them, and they work within our rotational model in math and conduct small groups in ELA. All of our City Year members additionally tutor after school until at least 4 or 5 o'clock. Clearly, their cost outweighs any other factors that may, you know, be of need. We will pay whatever it costs to have these students on our campus and really affecting change in our students at Evans. We also have tutors. We have UCF leads who work with our Student Government Association, and they really foster a community feel as well, and they look to maintain sustainability within a project that dedicates awareness and solutions for kind of mainstream needs. This year, they're focused on peace. And finally, our AmeriCorps VISTA really supports the work of the community school in the areas of recruiting volunteers, developing mentor curriculum, and creating a culture of giving back. Our students are matched with other students in the community and membership outside, including alumni, business members, etc. Oftentimes, our VISTA is really the center of the hub and is able to make those connecting pieces for our students, teachers, and then also our services as mentioned previously. Next slide, please. Our school does not have unique challenges when we're talking about being in comparison with other Title I high schools across the nation, but we are lucky to have these resources to put forth to address our students' needs. Attendance is a leading factor for student achievement, and if you aren't in class, you certainly can't advance your learning. Therefore, our service members, mentors, and tutors really connect to students who have chronic tardy or absentee issues. They are able to hone in on the problem, and our city year members have a focus list of students for both behavior and attendance, out of which they really build even deeper relationships with those students, which is about 25 each, and they hold them accountable and on track because those members are looking for those students every day, and there's accountability if those students weren't there, and there's also support if a student is going through a hard time. The community and campus mentorship is critical to our student success, and we really feel like this is where our academic achievement gaps are closing. Next slide, please. As you can see, our challenge is really in academic success as determined by various standardized exams. And so this year we've utilized tutors in and outside of the school day. And our teachers work through their lessons, gather data, and then really teach with our members and have the members engage in small groups, in rotations, and then in individual one-on-one instruction where needed. And to that point, our school grade has gone up from a C to a B this year in Florida, which is big news. But most importantly, when we look at our city year members who are in math and English, they're making 10 plus percentage points change just by being in the classroom and being dedicated to our students. Next slide. Our students feel safe in school as evidenced by the reduction of out-of-school suspensions and disciplinary referrals. And that really is due to the relationships that have been fostered on campus with the service year members and our faculty. We ensure that students have at least one connector on campus, and that allows for an outlet that may not otherwise be in existence. This is one of the biggest contributors to warding off bad behavior or poor decisions that sometimes can occur in high school. Next slide. Displayed for you is really our evidence that service year members have deeply affected relationships, and that has then shown itself in data points. So our students with mentors were able to show a 17% overall increase in their GPA for the last academic school year. Our character traits of pride, determination, and perseverance are really enhanced when someone else on campus exemplifies them as well and contributes to the students' lives in a positive and motivational way. Next slide, please. So what does service look like on our campus? It looks like cleaning out shrubbery and removing weeds while resodding the front of campus. It looks like college visits to places that students may have only seen on TV. It looks like hard work in class with small groups led by service members and tutors, and after-school tutoring to reinforce what still might be foggy. It looks like relationships that are embedded as a culture of Evans High School. We're certainly grateful for our service year members, and we're excited and thrilled to continue the journey. Thank you for your time today, and please feel free to reach out if you have any additional questions.
Casey, thank you so much. It's really impressive what all is going on at Evans High School and just kind of the wraparound supports that you've provided to young people there. So when we get to the Q&A section after Lee, we'll have a few questions for you. People are very interested. So right now, though, we're going to turn to our last presenter, who is Lee Foley, who is the managing partner with Capitol Hill Partners. And he's going to provide information about funding sources aside from the AmeriCorps program, which you'll hear about when Rosa comes back. But Lee is going to talk about a wide variety of funding that's available to support service programs. Lee?
Thanks, Betsy. Hi, everyone. I'm going to, there have actually been quite a few changes in federal programs that are positive, new programs, expanded authorities, and additional funding in this Congress and a couple in the at the end of the last Congress. And so I'm going to focus on those because those are probably more a greater opportunity when a program is new or when a program is expanded or when its authority is expanded or its funding is expanded. So I'm going to primarily focus on those in the time that we have and divide it into kind of three categories: early childhood development resources, K-12 resources, federal resources, and then finally, because a number of the federal post-secondary education access programs reach down into high schools, I'll talk briefly about a couple of them. One of the largest increases that Congress has provided on a percentage basis in domestic programs, and frankly on a dollar basis too, is the Child Care and Development Block Grant Program, referred to by the Department of Health and Human Services, the Child Care and Development Fund. This program budget, the appropriation for the current year, the year we're in now, received an increase of $2.4 billion, which is almost a 50% increase. And just so it went up to $5.2 billion, an increase of $2.4 billion. That money is just making its way down to the state and then on to the local level. And I can report just moments ago that the Senate passed the conference agreement on this year's appropriation by an overwhelming vote, 93-7, and it sustains that new level of $5.2 billion. The program is a block grant program, and so therefore there's discretion to states in what they do with the money. The bulk of the money does go to a voucher program for childcare in most states, and so families can use that money to bring those dollars to a child care provider. But there are also, the state can also make grants to organizations for the provision of child care and for services that ready children for school. And it can be a combination of those things. So some states adopt a dual way of doing this using both a voucher program and grants and contracts program. Some states only use a voucher program. Typically, they do have some money that they'll use for program improvement as well, and those can be grants and contracts. So a very, very large funding source, and recently much larger, and it's the kind of thing you can engage with your State Department of Education, because they're the original the State Department of Health and Human Services, because they're the original recipients of the money. In most cases, they pass the money on either through the voucher program or the grant program. So you can engage with them. You can also engage with the service providers at the local level who are receiving some of this voucher money or these grants or contracts. Secondly, Congress in the February budget agreement, which had numerous provisions attached to it, expanded the highly successful maternal, infant, and early child home visiting program, referred to by its acronym MCV. This program, some people refer to it, and this is a significant portion of the program, is the nurse home visiting program, and it's an intervention with mothers and young children to improve parenting and outcomes, child development outcomes for infants and toddlers. And these are discretionary grants that the federal agency, the Department of Health and Human Services, issues. The authority has been expanded and the funding is being expanded. So it's an opportunity to seek new activity, to engage in new activities and seek new funding. There is a very, very large amount of money flowing down to the states over the last 18 months with the bill that just passed the Senate today, just a few moments ago, and is likely to pass the House, highly likely to pass the House the week after next. Over the last 18 months, Congress has provided to states, will have provided to states, a total of $2.5 billion for what's called state targeted response grants. These are block grants to states to deal with prevention and treatment in regard to the opioid crisis. The first tranche of money went out a little more than a year ago. It was $500 million. Most states have not spent most of that money. Governor's original sort of attitude was, we're so overwhelmed by treatment demands that we're going to have to focus pretty much on treatment from the beginning and leave prevention activities for later on down the road. They were thinking the federal government would only provide 2 years of funding. In fact, the federal government has now provided 3 years and an increasing amount every year. So now they have the original $500 million, most of which they have not spent. They have also, there's also in the pipeline the FY18 amount of $1 billion, which they have spent none of so far. And then the appropriations bill that just passed the Senate floor will provide an additional $1 billion. And so a total of $2.5 billion, of which almost nothing has been spent. I think there's an opportunity there to approach states. Typically, their health departments will have these dollars, and talk to them about prevention programs, particularly interventions dealing with children and families that are impacted by the opioid crisis and the impact of that dysfunction in their household and chaos in their household on their education, and strategies that can be used to address that. Congress, in the February budget agreement, enacted a new program, new authority, new funding, quite unusual in this Congress or recent Congresses, sponsored by Republicans with Democratic co-sponsors. So again, unusual to be sponsored by Republicans with new authority, new funding, originally no offsets for the funding. The final bill did provide offsets. And it is a fund, a new fund, to test and demonstrate evidence-based, outcomes-driven strategies in virtually any domestic program activity area and across domestic program activity areas. So a state or locality working with a provider or providers could make an application to test an approach or to replicate an approach or to scale an approach that has evidence of success or potential for success, and which would make payments for outcomes as opposed that are verified, as opposed to only inputs and outputs, which is the typical payment structure for grants and contracts in federal programs. And the intent of the program is to inform future policy. So things that fail in this grants under this fund would indicate that federal policy along those lines should probably not be changed to adopt the strategies that were undertaken. Things that succeed would have the potential to be incorporated into permanent federal law as allowable activities. One of the major intentions, congressional intentions of this act, which is called Social Impact Partnerships to Produce Results Act, a lousy name and a lousy acronym, SIPRA, Social Impact Partnerships to Produce Results Act, is to do cross-silo strategies. And an example that I often use, I worked on this legislation for 5 years, an example I often used with members of Congress is that one of the top causes of emergency room visits by Medicaid-eligible, Medicaid-covered children is an asthma attack. One of the top causes of asthma attacks is mold in their household. If the mold in the household is remediated, the emergency room visits end, and therefore Medicaid saves money. But Medicaid rules do not permit spending on so-called non-health interventions. This would be categorized as a non-health intervention. So SIPRA could demonstrate and track that this approach is successful and literally track the savings, because it's a grant program. It doesn't have to rely on Medicaid funds, reimbursements for the intervention. It's a grant program that can show the intervention works. Congress continues to provide additional funding in the bill that just passed, now up to $9.9 billion annually for Head Start and Early Head Start. The program is a discretionary grants program, grants issued at the national level by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. So there is an opportunity for organizations at the local level, including service organizations, to apply for Head Start grants when they come due. Head Start is an holistic program that serves the needs of families and children and their families, and aims at early childhood development outcomes that make children ready for school. Temporary assistance to needy families is the largest domestic grant, federal grant, that governors receive. It's about $17 billion a year. And it too, like the Child Care and Development Block Grant, is often used to meet the child care needs of TANF eligible parents, particularly those who are in education, training, or work programs. Finally, not on the list that you're looking at, but something I did want to mention, it's not really a funding source for program activities in early childhood development, but it is a new funding source, and it's called the Preschool Development Grants, included in the new Every Student Succeeds Act, which amended the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, and it provides $250 million in discretionary grants to governors. Governors must apply for it, and this will be the first year they can apply for these grants, to work to develop a comprehensive approach in their state to child care, early childhood development, and preschool. So really planning and execution of a more integrated, holistic approach to that. It might be the kind of thing that you want to get engaged in as governors apply for these dollars and develop a planning and execution process, engage in that process. Moving to K-12 type funding sources, there is a very large new funding source, which is just coming down to local education agencies. It's Title IV-A of the new element of the new Every Student Succeeds Act, an amendment to the ESEA. It's called Student Support and Academic Enrichment Grants. These are block grants to states, which must pass nearly all of the money on to the local education agency. The local education agency is obliged to do an assessment of the needs for student support and academic enrichment grants. This is for Title I eligible students and schools. But the local area does not do a plan. The state does a plan. And the state has a menu of about 23 different things that can be a part of that plan to help these students and families succeed in school, have a more well-rounded and robust education in and out of the classroom, to make schools and children safe, to help them with things like financial literacy and outdoor recreation, things that might be outside the schoolhouse. And the last category is other things that the local education agency and the state feel are important. So it's very open-ended, and it has the potential to, it's a very large amount of money. It's $1.2 billion this year. A year and a half ago, it was zero. There are some former categorical programs under ESEA that feel they have a call on those dollars. Those categorical programs are no longer authorized in law, but it's really up to the state plan and the local officials to decide how to use these dollars. The bill that just passed the Senate keeps that funding level at approximately $1.2 billion. Again, money that's just coming down to the states now. Congress just passed and the president signed into law a new authorization for the Career and Technical Education Act. This program historically has funded high schools for their technical programs, community colleges, and literacy programs. And the new authority expands the flexibility that governors have in the utilization of these funds. And it specifically, and Service Year Alliance was a prime mover on this, explicitly expands to include new experiential learning, including service, that is called a new term in CTE, work-based learning. And the legislative history specifically includes service programs in work-based learning. So there's an opportunity as this new authority comes into play to approach your states, but also the local entities, community colleges, technical, local technical high schools or technical programs within high schools, literacy programs locally, to engage with them, to engage service programs with them. This new authority will get one of the largest percentage increases in the Labor, Health, Human Services, and Education bill, approximately a 10% increase. And there are two new innovation authorities that allow, for instance, service programs to come to the federal government and propose an innovative way of doing work-based learning through service as a model that could be demonstrated and then picked up throughout the CTE system if successful. There's also a reserve authority at the state level for the funds for governors to do high priority innovative approaches. So two new places to go to try new things that are outside the traditional CTE funding streams.
Lee, this is Betsy. I'm wondering if you can summarize the remaining points a little bit quickly. We still have other information that Rosa wants to provide and then hopefully allow time for questions.
Sure.
Thank you.
So spanning almost all age populations is a major reform of families of the federal child welfare system called Families First. The big change, particularly for the foster care program, is that you can spend so-called Title IV-E money, Title IV-E of the Social Security Act, before a foster care placement is made. That was not generally not permissible under the current authority and the previous authority. So this is a big change. As I'm sure everyone on the phone knows, education outcomes for foster care kids are horrible. And so the opportunity to use this uncapped entitlement funding source for those kinds of interventions is now there. I mentioned the social impact partnerships, new authority previously that applies to K-12. Community Development Block Grants, a $3 billion program. Most people think it's for physical development type things. A local board decides on grants, and those grants often involve education activities. So it's a federal dollar fund, but it's a local decision that's made on how to spend these dollars. Community Service Block Grant dollars flow down to local community action agencies. It's a large amount of money that they get annually. And they have wide discretion on how they use it, and they often use it for subgrants to other organizations. Finally, two funding sources that are post-secondary access programs that offer the opportunity for service organizations to apply for grants. Gaining Early Awareness and Readiness for Undergraduate Programs, the GEAR UP program, provides six-year grants to partnerships. They also provide them to states, but to partnerships that include not-for-profit organizations to provide early intervention for college preparation, starting with seventh grade and continuing with that cohort all the way through their high school experience. And finally, the TRIO program, multi-part program. I would cite the talent search program, the Upward Bound program as being grants, national discretionary grants that are made by the Department of Education that not-for-profits can apply for, that help students prepare for, become knowledgeable about their opportunity to go to college, and then prepare for the opportunity to pursue post-secondary education. Thanks, Betsy.
Lee, thank you. That is a really comprehensive overview of funding, and I just want to remind the folks on the webinar that these slides will be posted to AYPF's website and Service Year Alliance's website, so you can go back, get the links, check them out yourself. I know it's a lot to take in. And now we're going to bring Rosa Moreno back, and Rosa is going to talk about the funding available through AmeriCorps. So, Rosa, it's you're up.
Great. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Perfect. I want to thank Lee for outlining some non-AmeriCorps public funding sources to fund and support service year programs. I want to take just a little bit of time really quickly to do a few things. We hope we got you really excited about service as a strategy. We hope we got you thinking about how you might be able to apply this. We spend a lot of time talking about funding because most of the time folks ask us, how do we make this work? So thank you, Lee, for doing all of that. Over the course of our conversation, it was clear that many of these programs are AmeriCorps funded. So I want to be sure that you have information about AmeriCorps funding. To start with, the Corporation for National Community Service, also known as CNCS, is the independent federal agency that administers AmeriCorps. And yes, AmeriCorps allows schools, local education agencies, state education agencies, nonprofits, state and local governments, universities, college, tribal nations, and other entities to apply. So with federal funding from CNCS, schools across the country are using this source of human capital to help students succeed in school and in life. You can apply directly. You can apply in partnership with the city, state, university, or nonprofit in your community. You could be a service location for an applicant. As you heard us say earlier, there are a lot of ways you can engage, and we're happy to help you think that through. And so that includes partnering. Over half of CNCS's budget supports education-related programs, and AmeriCorps grants typically last 3 years or more. Most states have both a CNCS state office and a government-appointed state service commission, which I've linked here before you, and they can be your local contact for figuring out which national service program is best for you, and they're an exceptional resource for technical assistance. I wanted to flag for you a specific resource that CNCS has, which is leveraging national services in your school. So hopefully you can take a look at that. But before I turn it back to Betsy for questions, next slide, I wanted to introduce you to resources that we have. Next slide. We have a resource hub. The link is provided here at the end. It's a searchable database to discover resources that will help you get started. So Betsy asked questions about where should you get started and things you should consider to get started. And hopefully a lot of these resources will get there. For the sake of time, I'm not going to go through the description of the resources specifically that I wanted to draw your attention, but I'm going to just turn to the next slide so I can give you the titles. So these first two really quickly, we have a document called The Role of National Service in Improving Elementary and Secondary Education Outcomes in Low-Income Schools. The team here has since shared with you the link. I shared with you the resources.serviceyear.org hub where you'll find it. Another tool we have is about how an expansion guide, basically you wanted to be an expansion site for some programs. There are a couple highlighted here, including reading course, so you can find that. Next slide. We have one that's called Creating a Service Year Program. So if you're thinking this is something you might want to get started before you actually think about should you replicate, host, or expand, this is a good read to get you understanding more a little bit about what is this thing that they spent a whole hour talking to me about. Kind of gives you some background information. And then one resource that it's in production as we speak, and if it wasn't for me being the delay and the cog in the wheel, it would have been ready today, but I want to take the time to cue that up. And that's Service Years as a Strategy to Improve Education Outcomes. We've basically taken some of the key points that we've outlined here in this webinar, transformed them into a guide so it could be evergreen, and have taken the time to highlight specific programs, some of the models we talked today, just so that I know we covered a lot, but you could read that later. So these are examples of four resources that you'll find on that hub that we just directed you to. And then I think the last slide maybe directs you back to us. So here's a little bit about who we are and what we're doing. We have a mission to make service a common expectation and opportunity for all. We do it in lots of different ways. I don't need to take all your time to do that today, but know that we're here to help you. So on the next slide leads you a little bit to, at the end, I think we get the breadth, so don't skip ahead. But if you wanna learn more, you wanna start a program, you're interested, and we covered a lot, and we're gonna answer some of your questions, but we don't get to all of them, just email us. Our commitment is to help communities like you make use of this resource so you can be successful. And we're happy to talk you through what that could look like and give you guidance and direction. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it back to Betsy.
Great. Thank you, Rosa. And Lee, thank you again for going through all the different funding sources. Always an important thing to have money. So one question came in that I think probably is best directed to Lindsay and to Casey, and I think is relevant for lots of people who are running programs. But the question was, do you keep records or data to show that the children who are involved in these programs have grown or advanced in their skills? For instance, do you do pre and post assessments? So Lindsay, let me start with you and see if you have a response to that question.
I do, and I'm happy to have that question. So we actually have two data management systems. We're not very good at naming things. So one is called Reading Core Data Management System, or RCDMS. The other is Math Core Data Management System. But we collect, we do benchmarks of our students using several different assessments, including but not limited to FAST, CBM Reading, and PELI. We do those in the fall, winter, and spring, and we maintain those data records. That's why we built our own data management system. In math, we use Star Math. So yes, we're absolutely collecting those. And in Star Math, we do those every other month.
Great, thank you. Casey, what about you?
Yes, so we have benchmark assessments that are through our district at specific times within each quarter. And we utilize those as kind of our baseline for our city year members to not only develop their focus list for student support, but then also to maintain a record of, you know, what's changing, what standards are being of learning gains, and is that due to more city year intervention or a different strategy? So we have approximately, I would say, 8 major benchmark data pieces prior to our state assessments that we utilize on any given point in assistance with kind of our daily formative assessments, things like that, so that we can then plan for not only the current year's support, but then the following year's support. So every goal that we make with our city or members is really based in the ELA and math data that we collect from the year prior.
Great, thank you. Thanks, Casey. We have time for a real quick question directed to Rosa, maybe kind of a top level question, Rosa. But when you think about, we've heard about positive academic outcomes from the programs. What are some other benefits that you see service playing in communities? Rosa?
Yeah, can someone mind typing the question in, just because I continue to have audio challenges, although I think you all can hear me well. I caught the first part, which I think we said you heard some academic achievement. There was a latter part to your question I could not hear.
Yeah, so while hopefully Jesse's typing that question to you, what other benefits do you see service playing in the school community?
Great. Thing I got that in. Okay, so there are a number. I think there have been a couple things that I highlighted when I opened this, is that we have seen a lot of schools indicate that having service year core members has brought positive and improved school climate and culture. Having the near peers, because in many instances, while the core members' ages vary, oftentimes they are closer in age sometimes to the students than maybe the other faculty. So it has brought this renewed energy. The teachers have often talked about the benefit of having more capacity in the classroom, which allows them to do more focused, integrated, individualized work with their students, because then they just have extra hands and people who are part of the culture. There have been you know, programs to utilize the core members to enhance parent engagement and outreach. So maybe those types of things that maybe schools have been wanting to do but haven't been able to do. And so that has brought in new vibrancy. I think also it's not unusual, whether it's core members working in schools or in other nonprofits, oftentimes these core members stay involved and engaged in the community and or where they are. And so I think those are a few things I would need: positive school culture, climate, parental engagement, and the added value that brings, and a renewed sense of motivation and engagement from students from utilizing this additional resource. So as a result, the whole school is benefited above and beyond those direct academic achievement efforts that the programs focus on.
Great. Thank you, Rosa. So interested in starting a program? You just heard why you should. I want to thank everybody for all of our fantastic presenters today for sharing their knowledge and expertise with us. Please feel free to contact any of us after the webinar for follow-up. Remember that part two of the series occurs on November 14th at 2:00. There's a link on the screen, but you can visit our website or Service Year Alliance's website probably for more information. And finally, when you exit the webinar today, you will find a survey. We certainly encourage you to do that. It helps us as we develop these events in the future. And again, the recording and all slides will be posted on the AYPF website and the Service Year Alliance website. So thank you to our audience for listening to today's presentation. Thank you to our presenters, and we hope to see you at another AYPF event again soon. Thank you.